In this video, you're going to learn everything that you need to know to be able to work with the AI SDK from Vercel to build AI-powered applications. This video, being the first video that I do on this SDK, is going to be kept simple and only focus on the basics to get up and running and working with this SDK and build a simple AI-powered applications. In future videos, we're going to dive into more advanced topics because there is so much to cover and so much functionality that this enables us to do. So get ready, get excited, and let's get into the video. All right, so let's begin. So here I'm on the official homepage of the AI SDK. This is going to be ai-sdk.dev. And the AI SDK is, at least at the time of filming this video, the best tool that you can use to build AI-powered applications. They offer you a lot of functionality that makes it super easy, both on the backend and the frontend, to set up everything that is needed to build an AI-powered application, leaving you and us, the developers, to focus on what matters, which is how our users are going to interact with our AIs. So first, what you want to do is you want to click here on Get Started. And in our case, we're going to go here to the Next.js app router. Now, you don't have to use Next.js to work with the AI SDK. Even if the AI SDK is built by Vercel and so is Next.js, they actually support a bunch more other frameworks. So no matter what you're using, you're probably covered here. Just look at the documentation and pick the thing that you are using. In our case, we're going to be working with the Next.js app router. Now, this page over here is actually a very valuable source of documentation that I highly recommend that you go on your own time and actually read, because there's a ton of information here that is really useful if you're serious about building AI-powered applications. Also, if you want to build more advanced features that we're not necessarily going to cover in this video, look at all of these other pages over here. They are well documented. And again, it is a great resource to learn how to build with AI. So for us, what we want to do is we want to start scrolling down over here, and we're going to skip the creating app part because I already have an application created. But if you don't have one, feel free to run this command to create one. And here we're going to go and install the dependencies to get up and running with the SDK. Now, in our case, we're only going to take this part of the command over here. We're going to skip zot just because zot is usually used for things like tool calling or structured outputs, which is beyond the scope of this simple introductory video. We're only concerned with the AI library that is the core of the AI SDK, the React bindings for the AI SDK, which is going to allow us to connect this to React, and then the OpenAI bindings, which is going to allow us to call the OpenAI models. Now, if you want to use another model from another provider, you would not install OpenAI. You would install maybe AI SDK slash Google or Anthropic or whatever you want, to just go and find the actual bindings for it and just install that. Cool. So now let's go and open up an editor. Let's come here and let's paste our command to install our libraries into our project. Once that's done, we can come back here and we can see the next step for us, which is going to be to configure an API key, right? So whether you're using OpenAI or some other provider, you're going to want to set an API key to actually connect to that provider with your specific API key. So you want to create here a .env.local file, right? Which is typical in Next.js. And here the name that you put on this property over here matters, because if you specify something else, then the AI SDK is not going to pick up on it. So just put this exact one over here and then put your API key that you get from the OpenAI dashboard in here. Now, I'm not going to do it as part of this video because I've already done it. As you can see here, I have an end.local. I'm obviously not going to open it, right? But go ahead and do that in your project. Then we can come here and we can now create a root handler. So this is going to be the backend part of the AI SDK. And then if we look here at the documentation, we can see some very interesting things, and we can also see how simple it is to actually set this up fully end to end. So the first thing that we have here is we have this max duration constant that we exported. This essentially sets a limit that only allows the streaming responses to be up to 30 seconds. You would probably want to change this based on your specific use case, or in some cases you might want to remove it, right? Again, this is going to depend highly on what you specifically want to do. And then what we have here is we have a post function, right, that takes in a request. And actually, let me just copy this inside of our editor. It is going to be just simple if you just look at it. So what you want to do is you want to come here to your app directory, because we essentially want to create an AI endpoint for this, right, so that the frontend can call. And in here, you want to create a new file that is going to be /AI/chat and then root.ts. Now, of course, if you want a different endpoint, feel free to create a different endpoint. Whatever you put here is the way that you're going to want to call it from your front end. And let's just paste it here so that we can actually look at it a little bit better. So what we have here is we have a post request, right? So we're creating a post endpoint on API/chat. This one will take in a request as normal. And here we get the messages array, which is going to be from the JSON of the body of this request. This messages array is actually going to contain all of the messages, including previous messages of our conversation. So the whole chat entirely. We're going to be passing the entire chat to the model over here so that it has all of the contents on everything that was said so far. Now, when working with the AI SDK and AI in general, it's very important to know that the AI doesn't have memory. Every single time that you call it for something, it doesn't know what things have been said beforehand unless you explicitly provide it to the model. That's why here we're not just taking a singular message, we're actually taking an array of messages, right? Because we want to pass everything that was said thus far to the model so that it knows, because again, it doesn't have any real memory outside of what you provided as its context. Now, to be fair, this may not always be what you want. This may not always be your use case. In some cases, you can also come here and instead of providing an array of messages, you can provide a prompt. Maybe you just want to provide one singular prompt and not an array of messages. In this case, instead of doing that, you would just provide the prompt over here. That's another property that you can provide. The model is still going to work, but now it's not expecting an array of messages. It's expecting a singular unit message. Now, the next thing that we have is the model over here. So let me just undo this over here. We have the model here, right? So we're using the OpenAI. This is coming directly from the AISDK/OpenAI. This is the function that you can call to specific go to OpenAI and you specify the model that you want over here, and you're going to call that model with this messages or the prompt or whatever context you actually want. This is the really cool thing about the AI SDK is they provide these functions over here that you can just use to call any model that you want. They have the equivalent for Google, they have the equivalent for Anthropic, which means that you can choose any model that you want, and usually you also want to do that because some models are better suited for some specific use cases than others. Now, here's the important part. All of this is being passed to the stream text function. So this stream text function, what it is it essentially creates a stream of data from the model so that you can get the response of the model token by token instead of awaiting the whole thing to be done, right? Which if we're building a chat application, you want to give the response as soon as you can and not have the user wait for sometimes a couple of minutes, because some models sometimes take a lot of time before they can actually see something on the screen, especially if it's a long prompt. Now, stream text is not the only function that you can use and return from this backend. You can use a few others. One that I'm going to show you is generate text. And this one is going to do the actual way that I said, which is going to wait for everything to happen before returning a response. That's why here we have to await to generate text. This is going to halt this execution of the endpoint over here until we have the generation from the backend. And then we're going to want to return all of that. We can do here response.json. And here we can get the full text value of that specific response. Again, this is going to wait for the entire generation to happen before we can return it to the backend. In our case, for a chat app, that's not what we want, but for some specific use cases, that is what you want. So it's good to know that you have this as an option. So here we're just going to undo everything and we're going to put stream text because we want to stream our response. Now the stream text returns to a result, which is not awaited, again, because we're creating a stream. And this happens by calling result.toDataStreamResponse. And this is a nice helpful function that is just going to automatically create the stream response. That's the benefit of using something like the AI SDK, because it makes it really, really easy for you to just plug the logic, the business logic of how you want your AI functionality to work, and it does all the heavy lifting for you. Cool. So now with that, our backend is fully set up and ready for us to call it from the frontend to actually get these values and get this result over here. So what we want to do is we're going to come here to our page component. This can be any component in your application. The only thing, if you're working in Next.js, is this has to be a client component. So we have to put use client here at the top. And then what we want to do here is we want to use one of the most powerful hooks from the AI SDK, which is going to be useChat, which I have to unfortunately manually update because my cursor editor does not know that I have it installed, but I have it installed. We're going to get the useChat hook from the AI SDK, and this is going to be the React bindings for the AI SDK. And this one is pretty much going to do all of the work for us in a super, super cool way. So what we can do with the useChat hook is we can access some of the properties that it returns. For example, we can come here and we can do const, and here I'm going to do messages. And I'm just going to close this over here, and we're just going to get the messages for now. This is going to be, if I hover over this, the array of messages that are currently inside of our chat. So every single time that we send a new message, it is automatically going to be updated for us using this useChat hook. And we're just going to be able to use these messages and show them in our UI without doing any other extra work. So what we can do is we can just come here and we can replace this H1, and we can just paste some UI over here that is going to take the messages, map over each individual message, pass the ID of the message as the key. That is an ID that is managed by Vercel, by the AI SDK, which is really cool. Then we're just going to put here a whitespace pre-wrap class just so that it looks a little bit nicer. Then the message also has a role property, which here can be system, user, assistant, or data. Now, when it comes to the roles over here, so the first one that you want to ignore is the data role. As you can see here, this is deprecated. So we're only concerned with the first three. The user messages is the ones that you sent, that the user actually sends, the human messages. The assistant messages are the ones that the AI responds to. And then the system messages are messages that are set by the developer usually as general system instructions for the model. We haven't seen these yet, but we're going to see those in just a moment. So what we're doing is based on that role, we're checking if the role is user, then we're just going to put here a label of a user. Otherwise, we're going to put a label of the AI. It's very important to note that the system messages are not going to end up showing inside of the UI. You're only going to see the user and the assistant messages. And then over here, we have message.parts, and we're mapping over each individual part. Now, this is important because this is how messages are going to be for the future. Every single message will have multiple parts because AIs now no longer respond with just text. They can respond with a bunch of different things. For example, they can respond with text. They can respond with reasoning, right? So these models now think they can respond with reasoning. That is going to be a different part that you generally would want to show in your user interface. They can call tools, which are actually functions, so they can run code. So you would get those as parts. They can call sources and list sources as well, or they can actually have files or a step start. Ignore the step start. That is just something that the AI SDK puts there to help you. But really, there's all these different parts that you can actually use and show in the UI. Now, in our case, we're not going to be concerned with any of these over here. We're just going to focus on this text UI part. It's just important for you to note that they're all going to be under message.parts. That's why here we're doing message.parts.map for each individual part. And here we have a simple switch statement that checks for the actual parts. And we're only handling the text part over here, right? If you're handling multiple parts, you would just put more cases here to handle each specific part. And with this, all of our messages, as soon as we have new messages, the AI SDK through this useChat hook is just going to continuously re-render all of these messages, and we're always going to see the most up-to-date version of our chat, including everything that is being streamed from the backend. Remember, our response is coming in stream by stream, right? So token by token, and we're going to see that reflected in our UI. Every single time we have a new token, we're just going to see it directly appear in the UI using this messages property from the useChat hook. And then what we want to do is we actually want to come here and create a sort of input, right? So that the user can type something into and then send a message over there. So what we can do is we can come in here and we can create a form with a onSubmit property that we're going to pass handle submit that is also going to come from the useChat hook. Then we're also going to get and create an input tag over here. We're going to pass the input as a value again from the useChat hook, and on change we're going to pass the handle input change, which is also going to come from the useChat hook. So if I can come here and I just add all of these missing properties, we now get access to all of them. Again, this is really cool. You don't have to manage your submission function. You don't have to manage your input change function. You don't have to manage the value. Everything is managed by the AI SDK. Now, granted, if you want to do things a little bit more custom and extend this, you can. There are other things that the useChat hook actually returns that you can use to manually set values and manually call things. In our case, we're going to keep things simple and we're going to follow the documentation, because again, I don't want to overload this video with too much complexity. Cool. So now with this, I think I just need to change these styles over here. So we're just going to put this over here just so that we follow the same styles of the documentation. And now we should be good to go over here to just run pnpm dev and run our application and see our chat application in action. And there we go. We now have our local dev server running. We have a chat box here at the bottom and we can say anything. We can do, for example, hello, and we can press enter and see here message.role is user. So we're seeing hello. And then in a few seconds, the AI is going to respond. Hello, how can I assist you today? I'm going to ask it, who is Cosden Solutions? And let's see what it says. as of my last update, there isn't specific information available about a company called Cosmos Solutions. Damn, that's unfortunate. I'm not big enough to be known by the AI. Doesn't matter. This actually works, and we confirm that this works exactly as we expect, and you saw the streaming happen in action. Every single token that we receive from the backend, we're actually getting it back, and it just works automatically. Cool, so that is in a nutshell how to build a very simple AI-powered chatbot using OpenAI and the AI SDK. Now, we just want to go over a few of some important things that you're probably going to want to do if you're using this in production applications that are worth letting you know about. The first one is going to be here. You have message.role, right? We saw user, we saw assistant, but we did not see system. The system here is going to be your system prompt. So in our case, we didn't provide any system prompt. But what we can do here is we can do system, and we can provide any system prompt, any instructions that we want our model or AI to actually follow, which is really useful because generally you have specific use cases that you want your AI to handle, and you would provide instructions for those use cases in the system prompt. For example, we can say something to demonstrate that this works. We can say always respond in full capitals, capital letters, right? And let's see what this actually does. And let's maybe go and put for all many so that it doesn't cost me an arm and a leg for each every single request. So let's now go here, let's refresh, and let's say hello, and let's see, will it follow our instructions? See, there you go. It follows our instructions. It always is going to answer in capital letters. Hello, how can I assist you today? The system prompt is a great place to put any instruction that you want your model to have. And generally in production applications, your system prompt is going to be long. It's going to have a bunch of examples, a bunch of rules, a bunch of guidelines, and it's going to tell the model exactly what you want it to do. Because the more descriptive and the more detailed you are with the system prompt, generally the better that the model can actually follow your instructions and do exactly what you want. And then the last thing that I want to mention is the callbacks that the stream text can actually have. So if I come here and I do on, you're going to see that we have a couple of functions. We have on chunk, on error, on finish, or on step finish. These are really useful when you want to connect these AI responses to different parts of your application. Maybe you want to save the individual messages in a database. In that case, you would use on finish. Whenever the model is finished streaming, you would want to save that message in the database so that you can actually use it for the next request or using someplace else in your application. On error is pretty self-explanatory, right? Maybe you want to do something on error, and on chunk is going to be every single token that the AI model is actually streaming. Every single time that you have a token, you can actually run a function that is useful if you want to run some things on each token, right? These functions are useful, especially the on finish, because as you've seen, these messages here are not actually stored. They're only stored in memory, but we're not storing them in any sort of database. If you want persistent messages, so if you want to reload the page and still keep your same messages, then you would have to store them in the database and then load them and then pass them to the AI as the initial messages, which you could do again using this useChat hook over here. So here, this actually takes some options over here that you can provide a bunch of things. The first one is going to be API over here. So in case your API is not the default, which is app/API/chat, right? In case you want something else, which generally you might, because again, you might have multiple of these endpoints in your application for different use cases. You want to call different endpoints, right? The default is /API/chat, but here we can put something else. We can put API/chat2, for example, and then it's going to call the chat to endpoint. Obviously, we don't have it configured, so it's not going to work, but you get the idea. And then, as I said, if you want to provide some initial messages over here, you can do that. And you can provide here any array of initial messages. For example, let's let cursor kind of do something. I can put here, hello, how are you? And here, I believe I need to add the parts. And here we're just going to put a part text and then how are you? And let's see what else is missing. Ah, we need an ID. So let's put ID 1. There we go. And actually, cursor overcomplicating things, you don't necessarily need all of the parts directly. We can just put ID, role user, content, hello, how are you? And now if I just reload, every single time that I reload, I'm actually going to have these messages here, and I can type another one. I can say, hey, and see, now I have two user messages and the model should still respond in caps. Let's see if it does. Oh, right. I put chat two, right? That goes to show you that it doesn't work. If I just remove this and press chat 1, and now I can put, hey, again, let's see, the model should respond. There you go. It works exactly as we expect. Right. So that's the AI SDK in a nutshell, at least the basics of it. You can now take this and build a simple chat application. And I recommend that you do. You're going to be able to find this repository in the description down below. Play around with this, set this up, try to add some functionality to it, and go and absolutely read the documentation of Vercel of the AI SDK, because it is really, really useful. It covers a lot of different things. Like I said, there's a bunch more that you can do with the useChat hook. There's a bunch more that you can do with the different functions from StreamText. And even within StreamText, there's a bunch more things that you can do that we haven't covered. That is going to be for future videos on the AI SDK, because let's face it, the AI is the future, and building AI-powered applications is going to become a normal thing in a very, very short amount of time. So that's it. That's all that I have for this video for you today. If you enjoyed this, of course, leave a like, comment, subscribe. Really helps out the channel. My name has been Darius Cousin. This is Cousin Solutions, and I will see you in the next one. Ciao, ciao.